Hi, and welcome to Talking Tech. I'm your host, Alejandro Hoyos, and today we're here in Computex 2025, and we have with us Robert Hallock, and we're gonna be talking about the 200S Boost. And we also had the opportunity in the previous week to talk with Dan Ragland about the same technology. Hey, Robert, how's it going?
Hey, man, good to see you.
Good to see you, yeah. Too. For the people who are just getting to meet you for the first time, and there's been some changes, why don't you tell us, what do you do at Intel?
I'm the GM of the channel business, which is pretty much everything DIY, or anything that vaguely smells like DIY, like pre-built systems from companies like CyberPower, iBuyPower, et cetera.
Oh, that's awesome, pretty cool. And today we have you here to talk us a little bit more about the 200S Boost. So why don't you tell us, what is it, what it actually is?
Yeah, so I think kind of to level set, the industry has industry standard memory speeds that's ratified by an organization called JEDEC, and that consists of multiple companies. And JEDEC's goal is to create kits of memory that kind of one size fits all for every processor. But when we look at our designs, we have quite a lot of headroom in the memory controller, which previously could only be accessed by asking users to overclock, right? And that used to break your warranty. So when we got Arrow Lake in our hands with crazy high headroom, we recognized that we had this opportunity to maybe push beyond what is officially a spec in this industry, but admittedly do it in kind of a constrained way. You can't address all the motherboards and all the memory kits, but with a pretty generous package of options, you can hit these much higher memory frequencies. So DDR5 8000 is the upper limit of 200S Boost, and at the same time, we overclock other parts of the CPU, so the pipe between the CPU cores and the memory, it's bigger the entire way. And we can do that under warranty, all Z890 motherboards, yada, yada, yada. Okay. And nobody's ever done an overclocked warranty thing before, so that's new.
200S Boost is a one-click overclocking that's accomplished within warranty, and it improves gaming performance and other workloads. We created 200S Boost to give enthusiasts and gamers an edge of extra performance, but without having to go through the trial and error that's normally involved with overclocking. So it just makes the experience so smooth for them and gives them tangible performance. We really wanted to do something to tighten up the latency, and the unique architecture of the 200S platform and processors is that we have a multi-chip design, and the communication between chips is such that we could speed it up and reduce latency by increasing the die-to-die frequency and also the fabric frequency. All that is a single path between memory and the compute. And so that was a unique architectural opportunity that we wanted to take advantage of.
All the different tiles on the CPU all connect together with a frequency called die-to-die. And the main one that's from CPU cores to memory controller, which is in a different tile, that gets faster. Your memory controller is overclocked, the memory is overclocked, and then what you could call the NGU or the SoC tile, that has its own frequency. And that shuttles information around the chip, and that also gets overclocked. So you get many frequencies overclocked with one profile in the motherboard.
So one thing that our engineers are particularly proud of is back when the 200S architecture was being defined in 2019, we looked at it and we said, you know what, there's a chance to fundamentally change some of the overclocking knobs that we've had over the years. And one of them was in the area of die-to-die, that communication interface between each die in a multi-chip solution. And so what we found is that when you combine the die-to-die and fabric overclocking, you now have unleashed the ability to achieve higher frequencies and reap the full benefit. Before doing that, you could potentially create a bottleneck for those overclock levels. So by overclocking all three as a system, you effectively improve that whole path and thus improved your latency and bandwidth.
And if I understand that correctly, it's also like up to a certain frequency, right? Mm-hmm. Up to a certain voltages is not like you can just go crazy.
That's right. Yeah, when you start doing like warranty protected overclocking and, or just like validation in general, and I guess a word on validation, it's like, how do you, when I produce a spec, how do I guarantee that this product or that product can run the spec I print on the box? Well, it's this laborious process called validation, where a bunch of engineers go through sometimes manual, sometimes automated processes to test, okay, this frequency at a sweep of voltages, this frequency, sweep of voltage. It's very laborious, and it takes time. And to do all that work, you eventually arrive at what you call a bounding box, which is, okay, we think we can do this if the users stay within these constraints, right? This is your voltage limit, this is your frequency limit, and you need these parts, but if you play by that set of rules, we can do this for you. And kind of all validation uses that approach, but how far you push the frequency determines, like, can you support a ton of hardware or a more concise amount of hardware? And that's what 200S boost is focused on, like tightening up the hardware a little bit to get a really high frequency.
We use what's called the up to concept. So we allow up to certain frequencies for die-to-die and fabric. Those are both 3.2 gigahertz. And then for memory, the up to frequency is 8,000 megatransfers. Now the motherboard vendor has some latitude to decide what frequencies they want to select within those up to limits. And so you might see different boards make different selections, but in general, you're gonna see that 8,000 megatransfers on memory and 3.2 gigahertz on die-to-die and fabric.
Some boards, especially like the really entry level ones, maybe they can't do 8,000. They're not designed to do that, right? So right. We still want people to be able to take advantage of it. So maybe the most their memory can do on that board is 7,200. Okay, that's fine. We'll run it at 7,200. Other board vendors were just maybe not comfortable with having that little bit of gray area, and they say, okay, well, if you don't have the recommended memory kit, we're not gonna let you do this. And it comes down to each board vendor. They all have different risk assessments about how they feel about overclocking features like this. But for the most part, it's like a best effort. It's up to whatever memory kit you got, up to 8,000, we're gonna try to use it.
We really wanted to look at what is attainable for most users. And then we wanted to look at what performance point we could deliver with those settings. And then finally, we wanted to make sure we could wrap all that behind a reliability position that we could count on. And then that is really essentially that one-click 200S boost configuration. At the same time, if you're one of those overclockers that just wants to set whatever values you want, you want to go above 200S boost, you can still do that. But that part does not come with this 200S boost warranty.
What do you need in order to, like, what are the parts, what are the things that you need in order to have, to activate the 200S boost?
Yeah, you need the motherboard. So any Z890 chipset motherboard, that should be eventually eligible. BIOS updates are coming out. The premium flagship boards were first about a month ago, and some of the more mid-range options in that space are coming online now.
And partners include ASUS, Gigabyte, MSI, ASRock. And they will have a list of which boards that support 200S boost on their website.
You need a memory kit that has certain voltage and frequency requirements. They're a little detailed, but basically under 1.4 volts on the RAM is the big thing to look for. There's a web page we set up that lists all of those out so people can go find it pretty easily.
All the major memory vendors are playing in the space, and both the board vendors and memory vendors have QVL lists that can show you which modules work on which boards.
And then the last thing you need is a K-SKU, which is just any Intel, you know, 200S processor, like a 285 or a 265.
It's supported on our Intel Core Ultra 200S processors, those SKUs that end with a K or KF.
But if you have those three things, RAM, motherboard, CPU, that's all it takes.
That's awesome. So, okay, so those three, and the processor ends in K or KF, right? Depending, make sure that those are the overclockable ones.
And those are like the standard setup people have for overclocking anyway, right? So it's just like, you already have this, you can go to the next level with it.
And also, you also mentioned the BIOS, right? So you have to update the BIOS to the latest one.
That's right.
Oh, what do you need to change in the BIOS? How complex is it to enable this?
Very easy to turn on 200S boost right there through the BIOS. There's this one or two clicks and you are done.
It should say 200S boost on every motherboard, every BIOS, and that was a lot of work to make sure that's consistent across vendors, and we did all the right things under the hood to ensure that experience for users. And one of the reasons why, you know, we've been actually working on this since January, actually, is you have all these different motherboards, right? And how do you provide a uniform experience for the user, which in our case is one drop-down. You go into your BIOS, it says 200S boost on or off. Okay, behind the scenes, a lot actually has to take effect because not every motherboard is the same. Right. Sure, you've got a Z890 chipset, but they have different components on that board. There's physically a different number of layers of the circuit board, and those all affect some of the like hidden or invisible parameters that vendors have to change in their BIOS. And then you have to go every board, every vendor, every combination you think you're gonna run, and test it all. And that takes time, but that's how we get there.
We worked with them on their BIOS setup options, making sure that the board's default state is disabled, such that folks who are looking for that out-of-box experience to be at Intel defaults still get that. But at the same time, helping them with the help text and the setup options to make sure that those were very easy for users to follow.
there's only so much amount of resources that you have to validate for all this stuff. So there's like a specific amount of one of those.
That's right. And like leading up to launch, it's all the official JEDEC stuff, right? That's walking all the way from like 3200 all the way up to 6400 with multiple combinations of CPUs and motherboards. That takes a ton of time.
Yeah.
And then once that's stable, yeah, then we can look at the overclocking stuff.
And you've been talking about all these different vendors. How was it working with them? How is it enabling the ecosystem? It's very laborious.
Well, starting with a memory vendor is incredibly helpful. To achieve this 3-year warranty thing, we really need those memory modules to be 1.4 volts or less. Mm-hmm. And that was actually a rare combo in the market in January, February, seeing these 7,200 or 8,000 kits with that kind of voltage was relatively rare.
So with memory vendors, the big challenge was getting DRAM that could operate within the voltage constraints that we supplied them. And the cool thing about this is, if you stay within our up to voltage levels, you're actually getting higher quality DRAM. So they're actually sorting and finding better DRAM for you. So a 200S boost certified module is actually a really good thing, regardless of this program.
Huge credit to the memory vendors in the ecosystem for helping us make this real. And then huge credit to all the motherboard vendors. It's a lot of work on their side to get a feature like this working. They gotta do a ton of testing, and it's not free. Takes time, people. And so that was a big help as well. And we literally could not have done this without the support of our partners.
That's great. And it takes a whole team to
do it. It really does. It's easy to dream up this feature and go, man, it should work like this, but you need everybody else to come along for the ride with you. And it takes time, right? It takes time to call that memory vendor, go to their offices, okay, take their memory module, this motherboard, and just multiply that by the number of vendors, number of motherboard guys. It's laborious.
Yeah. Another opportunity we had was to have 200S Boost work in conjunction with our existing XMP program. And that was a really cool opportunity to really generate more excitement within the XMP world. And so we had modified our XMP specification for the SPD, the Serial Presence Detect, such that it would account for these new up to voltage limits we have. And then we worked with memory vendors on testing and bringing up a whole suite of 200S Boost supported memory modules, and those are all up on intel.com today, so you can check them out.
There is another program that we launched that was launched through Intel earlier this year, which is called IPO.
Oh yeah, IPO. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, can you tell us a little bit more about it, and how is it different from this one?
Yeah, IPO is a feature that's kind of coming out in the Chinese market now, PRC, or mainland China, and primarily for iCafes. So if you're not super familiar with the iCafe market in China, a lot of people consume their gaming through brick and mortar establishments, collectively known as an iCafe, and you basically rent time in a seat for a very affordable price to play on a very high-end computer outfitted with all these games. And those computers are almost always driven through what we call local OEMs or LOEMs, and these are companies that build computers, but maybe only for one city or region. And I guess it would be like, hey, I make computers for Los Angeles only or California only. When you have really tight control over the system build, right? It's coming from a system integrator. They're choosing the CPU, the motherboard, the memory, the power supply, every component. We can go a little further. We talked about validation being a function of how many things you have to test.
Right.
In IPO's case, it's a very small set of hardware, 4 pre-built systems, totally curated from end to end, so we can add in a little bit of CPU core overclocking too in IPO, which you can't really do and guarantee in a Wild West DIY type market, but when you control everything through your partner, you can do a little more. So IPO is basically everything that's in 200S Boost, plus some core frequency overclocking on the CPU.
Okay, and that's only offered in the PRC market.
Mm-hmm.
And also, and I guess the other reason that we wanted to do the 200S Boost is to be able to kind of copy that, but open it up to everybody
else.
Yeah,
as many people as we can, right? Because we were thinking about these overclocking features, and we have this headroom available. So how do we make it accessible to people? And how can we, okay, so for the IPO thing, yeah, we have this recipe of overclocking features, but it needs a really tight set of hardware. Okay, how do you deploy that? Clearly the SI system integrator, local OEM market is the way to go. Everything is curated from end to end. But when you have to go really wide, that looks more like 200S Boost. We have to back off a little bit on how hard you're pushing the profile, but it opens the window up for more people.
I know it's hard to talk about the future, but any hints, anything you can?
Well, I will say 200S boost, one of the things we wanted to accomplish was like getting a gut check from the industry about a technology like this. Nobody has ever done a warranty protected overclocking package before, and the team was worried. It's like, well, we can't cover every 8,000 module. We can't cover every motherboard combo. Is that still going to be okay? Or is there going to be the gaps that are created by that? Are people going to be unhappy with it? Feedback has been really good from users and media alike, and that is having, I can't really comment on the future, but that is directly affecting how we're thinking about the product design for next generation desktop CPUs. And specifically, it's encouraging us to be more aggressive with our product definition, because we see there is appetite for this, and some of the asterisks that might go along with that, people seem to be okay with. And so, I wish I could give the punchline, but it's really helping.
An exciting thing about 200S Boost is we're finding that it's drawing new people into overclocking. Folks that maybe don't want to mess around with changing mini BIOS knobs to do their overclocking, but rather are just looking for an easy one-click solution. That's been really exciting, and it's something we're going to keep an eye on and work on in the future to continue to make overclocking easier. Our engineers are eagerly watching reviews and hearing customer feedback about 200S Boost today, and what we find there will certainly shape the future of it. I like to say that today's overclocking is tomorrow's, in spec, so you're going to see that theme. I can't make any future product promises, but I believe we'll see 200S Boost or something similar to it well into the future.